Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to CEC EduSet Live Lecture. Dear friends, in previous session of EduSet Lecture, we discussed about fly ash. What are fly ashes? How they are produced? So, recalling again, I would like to tell you that we discussed how after the combustion of coal, fly ashes are produced. We discussed about the various disadvantages of the fly ashes. But in today's session, we are going to discuss about the advantages of the fly ashes. And for this, we have again with us in our studios, Dr. Arun Srivastav. He is Assistant Professor in School of Environmental Sciences, JNU, New Delhi. So, my dear friends, first of all, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Arun Srivastav, and through his immense knowledge and experience, I hope that we are going to learn more about fly ash, how they are advantageous. Hello, sir. Welcome to the EduSet lecture. As we have discussed in the previous session that how fly ashes are very, very dangerous to the environment. And today we are going to discuss about the advantages part of the fly ash. Recalling back from the disadvantages part, what would you like to say?
Yeah, well, there, first of all, the main concern about fly ash is that as far as disposal is concerned, one has to be very, very careful, because if it's not disposed properly, then more or less all the problems come. And if it is disposed properly, then its utilization part is there. Our main aim should be that it should become the part of atmosphere or the part of soil in due course of time. That is the most dangerous part. If it is not becoming the part of that, and if you are disposing it or if you are collecting it properly, then the utilization part is concerned, and there are so many immense utilizations of this fly ash. We will discuss it one by one. So, continuing that particular lecture, I mean the previous lecture, first few points of the environmental implications were left. So, I must, I think I should repeat that again. So, I told you that this is a very important air pollutant, because it contains many, at least 15 toxic elements. And that's why it is a major air pollutant. Apart from that, it also can contribute to the acid rain, global warming, radiation budget, as well as it it plays a very significant role as far as the visibility is concerned. So, apart from that, because these were the concern, these were the concern apart from that, it has also very crucial role to play as far as the ground is concerned. So, if the collection site where the fly ash is being collected is porous, I mean if it is porous, so the chances are that it can leach into the soil as well as in the underground water. So it can harm the underground water as well as the soil. This I think we have discussed in the previous class too. Apart from that, the embankment where it is collected, or sometimes these fly ashes are also utilized to make the embankments, if they are not strong enough and if it is broken, then the many problems. So, in the previous, it has been reported that fly ashes, ponds, dam or retention wall were built, but if they are not maintained properly, if the standards were not followed and if they are broken, then some catastrophic consequences can occur in the ecosystem. So, these were the underground, this particular slide show. Shows the how it can contribute to the groundwater, underground water, because it contains many toxic elements like arsenic, beryllium, etc. So, once it becomes the part of, or if it leaches to the underground, so either direct leaching or through the rainwater, this in the aquifer, so the chances are that the groundwater can be very, very harmful. Either that, or if it is spilled out from the bulk storage or where it is stored, then again it is fatal. It can cause some, it can generate some fatal results. So, in the past, now we will have some discussion about its disposal and market sources. So in the past, fly ash produced from coal combustion was simply entrained in the flue gases and dispersed into the atmosphere. This was very, very previously when the coal utilization was started, whether in the industrial applications or in the power plant. So these created environmental health concerns, very intense environmental health concerns. And this actually prompted a law which used to say that at least 99% of the fly ash shouldn't go to the atmosphere. So it should be 1% which is bound to go to the atmosphere. More than 99% should be properly collected or stored or utilized. It has been also known that worldwide more than 65% of fly ash is produced from coal power station is dispersed in landfill and as ponds. Now, as far as the utilities are concerned, it has got two major utilities. One is cement, another is building material. Apart from that, it has many other applications also that will come in the following slides. Again, to the utilities of fly ash. Fly ash is, as far as the constraints about the fly ash utility is concerned, because fly ash is highly diverse as far as its chemistry as well as the physics is concerned. And that is why its diversity lead to many of the misunderstanding, which places severe limitations on its current commercial use. And as far as utilization is concerned, fly ash has been used for the last over 63 years. And one more concern is that we are still not capable to explain why one ash performs satisfactorily in a particular application, while another ash apparently similar performs differently or on some occasion is actually detrimental to the product or process in which it's being used. So this diverse nature of fly ash restrain the utilization of fly ash properly, but the way outs have also been discovered. So utilities of fly ash, as far as utilities are concerned, they are building materials, cement production. These are the broad description of utilities of fly ash. They are building materials, cement production, embankment and other structural fills, waste stabilization, mine replacement, stabilization of soft soils, road subbase construction. Apart from that, it has uses in agriculture, whether it is soil amendment, fertilizers, cattle feeders, soil stabilization, stock feed yards or agriculture estate. Apart from these two or three major applications, it has got so many, number of smaller applications. They are given here. It starts from cosmetic, toothpaste, kitchen, floor, boiling bars, flotation devices, stove utensils, tool handles, picture frame, auto bodies, roof tiles, doors, windows, signposts, PVC pipes, etc., etc., railway sleepers, utilities poles. So around 30-40 minor applications are also there where it is being properly used. It is also used in paint. Now, as far as this reuse and recycle is concerned, so in recent years it has been increasing, the concern has been increased about landfill cost and current interests in sustainable developments. Other environmental benefits to recycle fly ash includes reducing the demand for virgin materials that would need quarrying and substituting for materials that may be energy intensive to create, such as Portland cement, etc. The way of fly ash utilization in order of decreasing importance, number one is concrete production, the second is embankments, afterwards is grout flowable, fill, etc. Then the fourth is waste stabilization, afterwards cement, mine replacement and stabilization of soft soils. As far as its uses in Portland cement is concerned, because it has some pozzolanic properties, fly ash is used as a replacement for some of the Portland cement content of concrete. It is used in concrete in place of cement. The use of fly ash as a pozzolanic ingredient was recognized as early as in 1914, although the earliest noteworthy study of its use was in 1937. Use of fly ash as a partial replacement for Portland cement is generally limited to C-class fly ash. Class F fly ashes can have volatile effects on the concrete, causing reduced resistance to freeze and thaw damage. Fly ash often replaces up to 30% by mass of Portland cement, but can be used in high dosage in certain applications. Fly ash can add to the concrete's final strength and increases its chemical resistance and durability. Fly ash can also significantly improve the workability of concrete. Apart from that, it has got uses in embankments. Fly ash properties are usually among engineering materials. Unlike soil, typically it is used for embankments construction. Fly ash has a large uniformity coefficient and is consistent and consists of clay sized particles. Engineering properties that affect the use of fly ash in embankments include grain size distribution, compaction characteristics, shear strength, compressibility, permeability, and frost susceptibility. Normally, all the type of fly ash used in embankments are class F. Nearly the maximum use of fly ash in embankment is of class F fly ash. This is a picture of embankment which is completely made up of fly ash. Apart from that it is also significantly utilized in soil stabilization. Soil stabilization is the permanent physical and chemical alteration of soils to enhance their physical properties. Stabilization can increase the shear strength of a soil and control the shrink swell properties of soil, thus improving the load bearing capacity of a subgrid to support pavement and foundations. Stabilization can be used to treat a wide range of subgrid materials, from expensive clay to granular materials. Stabilization can be achieved with a variety of chemical additives, including lime, fly ash, and Portland cement, as well as byproducts such as lime clean dust and cement clean dust. So now the building products are concerned, they are mainly the process are of different three types. One is by heat treatment, which can produce refractory bricks, granites, etc., ceramic tiles. Then by geopolymerization, it can produce paving block, self-gauged glazed tiles, cement concretes. And apart from that, there is a pre-processing. The pre-processing of fly ash, which can give various other products like blended cement, etc., mechanical activation, etc., activated cements, etc. So these are the different three processes by which the fly ash can be utilized as far as the production of building materials are concerned. So now we'll discuss one by one the major building products. One major is asphalt concrete. Asphalt concrete is a composite material, consists of an asphalt binder and mineral aggregate. Both class F and class C fly ash can typically be used as a mineral filler to fill the voids and provide contact points between larger aggregate particles in asphalt concrete mixer. This application is used in conjunction or as replacement for other binders such as Portland cement or hydrated lime. The hydrophobic nature of fly ash gives pavement better resistance to stripping. Fly ash has also been shown to increase in stiffness of the asphalt matrix, improving rutting resistance and increasing mixed durability. So this is a picture of asphalt concrete which has been produced using fly ash. Apart from that, it can also be significantly utilized for the production of geopolymers. Basically, geopolymers are a class of inorganic polymers formed by the reaction between an alkaline solution and an aluminosilicate source of feedstock. The hardened material has an amorphous three-dimensional structure similar to that of an aluminosilicate, and that is why fly ash is highly utilized for the production of geopolymers. More recently, fly ash has been used as a component in geopolymers, where the reactivity of fly ash glasses is used to generate a binder comparable to a hydrated Portland cement and appearance and properties, but with possibly reduced CO2 emissions. These are the picture of some of the geopolymers. Apart from that, it is also used in roller compact concrete production. So another application of using fly ash is in roller compact concrete dams. Many dams have been constructed with high fly ash contents. Fly ash lowers the heat of hydration, allowing thicker placements to occur. This has also been demonstrated in Ghatgar Dam project in India. So these are the pictures of compact concrete dam made up of fly ash. Apart from that, fly ash is significantly being used in production of bricks. There are several techniques for manufacturing construction bricks from fly ash, producing a wide variety of products. One type of fly ash brick is manufactured by mixing fly ash with an equal amount of clay, then firing annealing at about 1000 degrees centigrade. Another type of fly ash brick is made by mixing soil, plaster of Paris, fly ash and water, and allowing the mixture to dry because no heat is required. This technique reduces the air pollution. More modern manufacturing processes use a greater proportion of fly ash and a high pressure manufacturing technique, which reduces the high strength brick with environmental, which produces high strength brick with environmental benefits. These are the pictures of bricks manufactured using fly ash. How the bricks are manufactured using fly ash? Initially, it is mixed with cement, sand and water in one type of brick production. Then pouring of mortar into the molds, then drying in atmospheric temperature and pressure. Afterwards, curing for a period of 28 days, removing from the molds, fly ash bricks are produced. So there is no need of furnace, no need of fuel, no need of coal, and ultimately we are saving fuel plus we are saving the environment too. This is a composite picture of fly ash production, how the fly ash is manufactured. In this, it starts from number 1, that is known as jar crusher, to up to 20, that is also known as boiler. So this is the automatic process of fly ash manufacturing. Sometimes at the thermal power plants where the fly ashes are produced, these type of machines are there. And on one hand, the fly ash is being produced. On the other hand, these fly ashes are getting converted into the bricks. And this is the picture of one of the machine, which is basically a high pressure machine that can produce the bricks, fly ash bricks. So it doesn't require any fuel, I mean any burning process for the heating or for the drying up of the bricks to give the strength. But here in this particular machine, the pressure is applied. And with that high pressure, which is actually in place of the temperature, high temperature. So in this case, high pressure gives or produces the fly ash bricks. So in this particular picture, we can see where the fly ash bricks are manufactured more or less north to northeastern India has significantly developed itself for the production of fly ash bricks. Now, what are the advantages of fly ash brick versus the traditional bricks? As far as the energy consumption is concerned, in case of fly ash bricks, the energy consumption is more or less zero, it is negligible. As far as the emission during manufacturing is concerned, it is also negligible. And as far as production per day is concerned, it can produce over 6,000 bricks per day. As far as the plant's installation cost is concerned, it is between 12 lakh to 25 lakhs. So here we are having different 5 types of bricks. One is fly ash bricks. A comparative statement is given here: vertical shaft brick clean, hybrid Hoffman clean brick, compressed earth blocks, then the bulbs trench clean, bulbs trench clean in moving chimney. One is in fixed chimney, another is in moving chimney. So we can see here that more or less in all the cases, the bricks produced using fly ash is best as far as the energy consumption as well as the air pollutant emission is concerned. Now, apart from that, it also has a very advantageous point as far as the global warming is concerned. Here in this particular picture, we can see there is a comparison between the CO2 emission in traditional concrete bricks as well as the bricks made by fly ash. So we can see here the global warming potential of traditional concrete bricks are significantly higher as that of concrete fly ash bricks. because this bricks are having many components. They are Portland cement, water, sand, gravel, admixtures, plaster mixture, as well as the fly ash. So in case of fly ash bricks, we can see the water, Portland cement's composition is maximum as far as the global warming potential is concerned, but it is again lesser in case of fly ash bricks than that of traditional bricks. Now, as far as again the carbon footprint is concerned, it is very much better than that of traditional or clay bricks. Here we can see here in this particular picture, it is the carbon footprint is significantly lower in case of fly ash bricks than that of traditional clay bricks. So in this particular picture, we have different three components. One is manufacturing electricity, then manufacturing gas, and the third one is raw material. So here in this fly ash bricks, we can see that manufacturing electricity CO2 footprint is more or less equal, but as far as manufacturing gas carbon footprint is concerned, fly ash bricks carbon footprint is more or less zero in comparison to traditional clay bricks. Now, what are the advantages? What are the major advantages of fly ash bricks? It has high compressive strength. It has low water absorption. Its dimensional accuracy is significantly uniform than that of clay bricks, because clay bricks are baked, they are formed in furnaces. So, controlling their dimension is very difficult, but in case of fly ash manufacturing, it is manufactured in a controlled manner, so its dimension is more or less maintained uniform. Apart from that, it has high strength to weight ratio, and it has more or less no emission of greenhouse gases during production. It has zero efflorescence. Apart from that, it consumes less mortar in construction, because in construction the traditional clay bricks requirement for mortar is more than that of fly ash bricks. Apart from that, it can also be utilized for metal matrix composites. One picture is given over here. So fly ash can also be mixed with molten metals and cast to reduce overall weight and density due to the low density of fly ash. Thus, the metal composites made are lighter than that of the original metal blocks. As far as its relevance to India is concerned, in India over 60% power generation is from coal. Coal has a low calorific value and very high ash content. Various Indian thermal power plants produce about 175 tons of fly ash annually. India produces about 350 tons of cement annually. Here, in this particular picture, there is a data of fly ash production versus the utilization from 1990 onwards to 2010. Apart from that, a projected ash production is also given for 2030. We can see here its production is increasing continuously. I mean, every 5 years it has been increasing significantly, and it is bound to increase significantly in the coming years. But as far as utilization is concerned, it is also increasing. More or less, we can see here in 2005 onwards or 2005 on 2010, we can see that its more or less its utilization is around 50 or near 50%. So the utilization is also significantly increasing. As far as the mode of fly ash utilization of India in year 2010 and 11 is concerned, it is depicted here. It is its maximum use was there in cement industry, where it was utilized around 50%. The next one was road embankment reclamation, etc., where it was used around 13%. Then the road embankments, etc., where it was used around 11%. And apart from that, it was used in agriculture, mine filling, etc., and other uses. So in case of other uses, there were 10% utilization. So this particular picture shows the production versus utilization of fly ash worldwide. India produces around 175 tons of fly ash annually, and it utilizes around 38%, roughly 40% we can say, while China produces 100 tons of fly ash annually, and it utilizes 45%, while USA produces more or less than half of Indian production, that is 75 ton, but its utilization is also significantly more, that is 65%. Apart from that, some European countries like Denmark, Italy, etc., they produce very less amount of fly ash, that is 2 ton per year, but its utilization is around 100%, so they more or less use all their fly ash produced. As far as world's bricks production is concerned, the leader is China. Around 54% of total bricks produced worldwide, China's contribution is 54%. Next one is that is 23% by other countries. India contributes around 11% to the world's total fly ash brick production. Bangladesh and China also has significant contribution. Pakistan contributes around 8%, while Bangladesh contribution is 4%. Here in this particular picture, worldwide utilization of fly ash is given. In the previous picture I showed, that was the India's utilization diagram. But in this particular picture, the worldwide utilization is concerned. Here we can see around 50% of the fly ash produced worldwide, maximum utilization of fly ash in the sector of concrete production, and the next utilization is in the formation of embankments or fills, and the third one is in the field of cement manufacturing. As far as the fly ash utilization status of India is concerned, from there is a comparative statement between 1994 and 2008-09. We can see here in as far as utilization is concerned, in 2000 the fly ash utilization was in 1994 the fly ash utilization was very less, and unutilized ash was significantly more in 1994. But in 2008-09 we can see the unutilized fly ash is also increased, but the utilized fly ash is also increased. Utilization is also there, as well as unutilized fly ash or the leftover fly ash is also there, but the ratio is decreased over the time. Here in this particular picture, usage of byproducts and reutilization level in 2000, because sometimes what happens, this byproduct means the fly ash is utilized for the manufacturing of some material. Afterwards, when this material is manufactured, become the waste, they are reutilized. So in this particular picture, the reutilization process is given. It is initially it was decreasing from 2007 to 2009, but afterward it has increased. It has got two reasons. One is that we are reutilizing the byproducts. The second one is the leftover material of the products are also decreased. That is why it can be. Now, how the fly ash is utilized in waste treatment and stabilization processes. Fly ash, in view of its alkalinity content and water absorption capacity, may be used in combination with other alkaline materials to transform sewage sludge into organic fertilizers or biofuel. In addition, fly ash, mainly class C fly ash, may be used in stabilization or solidification process of hazardous wastes and contaminated soils. So these were the utilizations and the positive sides of fly ash. And with this, I think the fly ash topic is over from my side. So, if you have some questions.
Yes, of course, I would like to have some questions. When we are talking about the disadvantages part of the fly ashes, that how harmful they are for the health, how could we segregate or differentiate on the part when we are talking about the advantages? If we are talking about the byproducts, the byproduct of coal, if we wish to know the advantages and the disadvantages part.
No, there are two things. One is that fly ash is actually the waste material produced from the thermal power plant or some other industrial process. So our aim is that it should be removed properly from there or removed safely from there, and it is not advisable to keep it for longer time, because if it is kept, it will become the part of atmosphere through winds, erosion, etc., or it can leach into the ground. So both ways it is dangerous. So our aim is that one thing is that it is brought from the furnaces, etc., it is kept somewhere at a safe place, and it should be utilized as soon as possible. So its utilization has got many dimensions, many type of utilizations are there: cement, concrete, road pavement, etc., etc. And afterwards what happens, because this fly ashes, suppose we have made road blocks or tiles. So the tiles are not there forever. Mm-hmm. Either naturally, I mean, if it is destroyed, or over the time when its age is over, it is bound to be destroyed. So the now we are getting the second generation fly ash. One fly ash which was produced from the thermal power plant, it was used for the manufacturing of brick or tiles. Then the tile is again becoming a producing agent of fly ash. Because if it is destroyed or if it is crushed, because the metallic content or toxic elements, etc., are still there. So then the waste product of those fly ash products should also be utilized. Mm-hmm. Because if it is kept waste, then it is bound to create harmful effect. So that is why these are known as the byproducts or the secondary products of the fly ash, second generation products of the fly ash.
That is, you want to say that they should not be let out in the open so that they
destroy the atmosphere.
Never. But if they are stored well and they use for the specific purposes,
it
as
should
you said,
be utilized as soon as possible. As far as the byproducts or the secondary products are concerned, they are comparatively compact. I mean, they are compacter than that of the original fly ash. So the removal of fly ash from its stocking previously was more than now. But still it can be removed or it can be eroded off from the products too. Mm-hmm. So the because it contains the many dangerous or hazardous metals, etc., so it is not advisable to keep it as such for a very longer duration.
As you explained in previous lecture also, that it is a cyclic process, that from
definitely.
Air to sand or soil and then to water, the cyclic process continues, and that's why the fly ash has become very dangerous for the environment. But if they are placed or utilized in a very concrete form, as you said about the dams could be built or the roads can be built, then it is not it is not destroying the atmosphere as a whole. Now this question arises, if fly ashes are so important that they can be utilized, what do you feel so that why, if the fly ashes production is so high, why we are not able to utilize them as if we talk about India alone?
Yeah, the major thing is that in India, as I mentioned in the pictures also, the demand of electricity generation is increasing continuously. And more or less, I mean, whatever the electricity we get, it is from the thermal power plant. So out of those thermal power plants, 65% is produced from the coal-based thermal power plants. So this is why the demand is increasing. So the coal-based thermal power plants numbers are also increasing. Or to enhance the capacity for the production of electricity, we have to employ more coal. And definitely, if you are employing more coal or if you are putting more coal, so the fly ash generation will be more and more. As far as its manufacturing brick is concerned, still, I mean, whatever the technologies we are having in India, as far as the brick is concerned, they are not indigenous, they are imported. The machine, etc., are imported from the foreign countries. So, I mean, they couldn't be efficient to produce as much as the fly ash is being generated. I mean, production of fly ash and utilization of fly ash are not same, not at the same level. So, the fly ash is still not being 100% utilized, but they are increasing. Cement industries are a very big consumer of fly ash in India. More or less, nowadays, all the cement industries in India, they take fly ash from the power plants. That is why if you go to any near the power plant site, especially the coal-based thermal power plant site, you will find more or less all the major cement producing companies have their factory there only in the vicinity of thermal power plant. Because one major reason is that its transportation is again risky. If the fly ashes have to be transported for a very, very long distance, then its leaching or its removal into the atmosphere becomes very important. That is why the cement industries are always in the vicinity of thermal power plant. One more thing I would like to say, that still in India we depend mostly on the traditional bricks. We are not, nowadays it is not that common men are using the fly ash brick for the construction of their houses, but still we see its efficient or very frequent utilization in the road blocks, road pavements, etc., or some monuments. So if people start using the fly ash bricks over the traditional bricks, then its demand will zoom up. Its demand will zoom up, then the fly ash bricks production will zoom up. One more thing, that its cost, as far as the individual bricks cost is concerned, over the clay brick, because in India we are a very, very populous country and the demand of brick is also significantly much, but the clay bricks demand is very, very high than that of fly ash brick. One more reason, as I was saying, one very important reason is that still the fly ash brick in comparison to clay bricks, which is the common man's brick, we can say, is still dearer than that of clay bricks. That is why its utilization or its demand is lesser.
So you also talked about or you used the term the sustainable development. If you talk about the advantages part of the sustainable fly ashes, if some products, for example, as you said about the dams, the various parts which are used in building also, as well as many a times we have seen that we in the country like India, where in many areas there are open pits, if their covers could be made. If we try to understand what we need in our country, where at what part do we need to have the system, do you feel so that these fly ashes could play a pivotal role?
Definitely, the fly ash, as I showed in the picture, that the fly ash has many advantages apart from the individual's advantage, because its longevity or its age is concerned is better than that of clay brick. One more thing, as I mentioned, that its requirement for the mortar in construction of building in case of fly ash bricks is lesser than that of clay brick. So although we are spending more money for purchasing of fly ash bricks than that of clay bricks, but on the other hand we can save some money using less mortar in case of fly ash brick than that of clay brick. So in this way, but people should understand it. If they start understanding this, so one day will come then that when people, the houses, etc., will start be constructing with the help of fly ash bricks than that of clay bricks, which is widely used nowadays, then its utilization will zoom up and its its production as well as its removal, I mean our concern will decrease. It will be more and more removed or more and more consumed. So its atmospheric or the water concern, what we are talking about, underground water concern, will decrease significantly.
We yesterday talked about the how the fertility of the soil is destroyed because of the fly ashes, and now we are talking about that they can be used as fertilizers also. How this is possible, sir?
Yes, they can be used as fertilizer. It depends upon the composition of those fly ash. I mean, first we'll have to determine the chemistry of, because as I said, it contains CaO, Na2O, etc., iron, etc. So somehow these metals are required for the soil's fertility. If we know the chemistry of the soil, and if we put fly ashes in a controlled manner to the soil, definitely in cat it can increase up, but it has to be given to the soil in a controlled manner.
Definitely, sir. Does this fly ashes can also be used in producing the submarines?
Submarines?
Yes.
I don't think that it will be utilized for the production of submarine, but it has got many uses. I mean, it is used in cosmetics, etc. Mm-hmm. Here I'll show you in this particular picture.
Thus, we can say that the fly ashes, if some part of the fly ashes is used in making of certain products, it could be useful. We can say that.
Yes.
Of course, it is not useful for the environment as alone, because when it directly hits the person, it is harmful then.
Yes. But it's, you know, its binding is required. The fly ashes in powdery form is dangerous. Once it is used, here you have range of products. I mean, over 40 products ranges there. It is used here everywhere. I mean, automobile, it is used in cellular concrete, roofing tile, utensils, etc., cosmetics. It is used in toothpaste, it is used in doors, it is used in paints, it is used as a binding agent, it is used as a fireplace material. So it has got a range of various uses, but the thing is that we must have some indigenous technology to get the proper utilization of fly ashes as far as the different products are concerned.
As well as while producing the all those products in which fly ashes are used, one needs to also identify the proportion or the ratio to which the fly ashes to be produced.
Otherwise, although they are different, they are certain materials, certain literatures are there for the proper utilization for any particular products. So we'll have to find out if we are going to manufacture a specific kind of product. So what should be the percentage, what amount should be there, and if the content of fly ash is not optimum, that whether it can be utilized or not. For these literatures are available, and if we go through it, so it can be properly utilized for a specific type of product.
So when we talk about the utility of fly ashes, as we have discussed in previous lecture also, that we have three types of coals, and after combustion of that coal, fly ashes are produced. So the fly ashes obtained after the combustion of those three coals, the fly ashes so produced, their utility also changes?
Definitely, that is why I said you in this particular slide, that sometimes some product of a same fly ash, fly ash part is not very, very good or very useful. I mean, sometime it can be disaster, but sometime it is very, very useful from the same product, because it is highly uncertain, because you know it has highly variable physics as well as chemistry. It is not that the chemistry of fly ashes are variable, I mean chemical composition of are variable, but the physics is highly variable. Physics means its water absorption capacity, its crystal structure, its hygroscopic nature, its strength, its adhesing character, etc. So these diverse physical as well as chemical properties sometimes make a product very, very useful, and from the same fly ash, the same product can be sometimes disastrous.
You also use terms such as LKD and CKD while delivering the lecture. I would also like to know through you that what these LKD and CKD are, and how they contribute if we talk about the fly ashes. What are their contribution?
Yes, well, you know, in cements, cement has got various components, various chemical compounds, etc. So one part, the mandatory requirement of cement is either lime clean dust or cement clean dust. So I was mentioning that in case of fly ash, this lime clean dust and cement clean dust can well be replaced with the help of fly ash.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's a kind of replacing material for LKD as well as CKD.
Sir, you also use the term that is geopolymers. How these geopolymers are associated with the fly ashes? What can we say about what
these geopolymers? Geopolymers are basically, it is grown, I mean, it's a kind of polymer, like polythene is a polymer. Similarly, fly ashes with the help of suitable chemicals can be utilized for the production of geopolymers. Here in this particular picture, different three types of geopolymers are shown. We can see one is very beautiful here, and apart from that, we can see it is embedded with some material and is making it very solid. So these geopolymers ultimately become the part of building material depending upon our requirement, and we can mold in them, or we can grow them, or we can manufacture them as we like to. I mean, we want in a spherical form, we want in cubical form or cuboidal form, or we want in some ornamental form, then also it can be manufactured. As far as basically it's a kind of inorganic polymer, and is formed between by reaction between alkaline solution and aluminum silicate. Since fly ash contains a significant amount of aluminum silicate, and if we put some alkaline solution in it, and under controlled temperature and pressure conditions, this polymerization process can begin. So with the help of this fly ash, we can manufacture or we can produce geopolymers.
Sir, there is a question running in my mind. If I'm not wrong, can these geopolymers, as you have shown through the diagram, can be used for flooring also?
Yeah, it is used for flooring. It is used for flooring or building materials. It is used for flooring, roadside pavement, etc. These are just for the utilization of, it is a part of building material.
Okay. Now, as we have very less time left, just recalling the things which we have come to know through this lecture, please, in a very simple terms, in simple way, try to explain us what is the difference between the traditional bricks and the fly ash bricks.
Yeah, traditional bricks, as I mentioned earlier also, it is basically made up of clay, and we have seen that red color brick, which is widely used across India, throughout the India. So we'll have to collect some clay, then we put it in some mold, then it is dried up in open for some time, so many labors, etc., involved. So after drying, it is put in furnaces or kilns, and there's a chimney. So there are two major disadvantages. One is that a huge amount of air pollution or the pollutants were being emanated through chimney. So we are making atmosphere polluted on the one hand. On the other hand, the place where this lime kilns were, where the brick kilns were made, that soil or that portion becomes totally infertile, meant totally unusable, means afterwards, if it is in some form, this farming can't be done once the brick kiln is made there. So in this way, it is destroying the atmosphere, as well as it has destroyed the soil, the fertility of that region. But it is quick, soil is readily available in India, so still it is being, and it was widely used previously too. But as far as the fly ash brick is concerned, the fly ash is obtained from somewhere. We don't need to put water into it and make mud out of that to put in a mold and then to dry up. Just we put in some mold where it is pressed at a very, very high pressure. Then, and immediately afterwards, the fly ash bricks are produced. So thus, we, on one hand, we are saving the air. I mean, the air pollution emission is lowered, Apart from that, it is not requiring a huge amount of land where the brick kilns are, this furnaces, etc., are required. So, on we are also saving the soil fertility.
That is the fertility of the soil we talked about, that how fertilizers can also be made with the help of the fly ashes. And as Dr. Arun Srivastava explained in detail, the utility part of the fly ashes, we all wish that most of the fly ashes could be used in the utility portion, and we expect and hope for the healthy environment. With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so very much for delivering such a nice lecture, and I would like to tell all the viewers that Dr. Arun Srivastava would be again with us, and we would be discussing a new topic. Till then, take care. Thank you, sir.